Church family.
It's Sunday, March 12, 2023.
And we are so glad you're joining us for church today. Pastor Phil has been encouraging us on the subject of trust.
Okay, so when I first came to the United States as a grad student, I used to stress about a lot of things. I was so confused about so many things. You know, my schoolwork, related with my PI, culture, everything. I had to adjust to so many things. I was always looking forward to, you know, opportunities to share my research and things like that. And it seemed like it wasn't happening. But over the years, I've learned to just depend on God. And I've seen Him open doors for me. So I've just learned to rest in God, trust Him that even if I'm not where I want to be, but I'm not where I used to be.
I have personally trusted God for my father's health to improve over the years. And surprisingly, the health condition hasn't changed for the better. But one thing I've learned in this process is the peace of God in my heart. Despite the fact that the outcome hasn't changed, the Lord has ministered His peace in my heart, and I have learned to trust Him and just to remain in that place of rest, even pending when I see the physical manifestation of the results I expect.
And so, because our God is infinite, whatever it is you're going through is an opportunity for you to trust in Him. It doesn't matter what it is, God is faithful, God is able, and He will always come through for us because we're His children.
So come on, jump up and rise up, and let's give all the praise to the King of Kings, who deserves our praise and who deserves our trust.
Welcome to church!
Church, what a good day it is to join together as God's people, to praise Him, to celebrate Him, to say, Lord, we trust You. Here we go. I'm in a fight, not physical. I'm in a war, but not with this world. You are the light that's beautiful. I want more. I want all that's Yours. Joy unspeakable.
I'm counting on God.
in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. And blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Let's bless him today. Here we go. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your Lord. lifted higher, be lifted higher.
Remember that trust isn't a denial of the reality that you see and feel, but it's an acknowledgement of the reality that is higher than that, and the reality of a God who is God, who is sovereign, who is in control, who is good, and who loves you, who has purpose and plan even for this thing now. This is a place of true trust, not denial. But trust in the Lord your God.
Daily, daily, I encourage you to take full advantage of what I have provided. Don't think that what I provide today will not be there tomorrow, and so you need to hold something back. No, daily, daily partake of what I've provided, for it was a once-in-a-lifetime experience for me, but for you, every day I bring provision.
I came to give you salvation, and at that time I gave you my gifts. But I still have more gifts to give you. And in order to receive them, you must choose. You must choose to either empty yourself completely of yourself so that I can fill you, or continue to have part of you with part of me. If you want the whole depth of me, you must empty yourselves, because I cannot fill that which is already filled. And when you're filled with yourself, I cannot fill you with me. So trust, the greater gifts are still there. There's more to be had. Empty yourself and then open yourself up completely in trust to me.
Yes, there is love that came for us, humble to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again, victorious. Faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire. There is truth that sets me free, Jesus Christ who lives in me. You are strong. Stronger, sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. You are strong.
In all the earth. Yes, Lord. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. We just want to glorify your name. We just want to glorify your name. God, take our lives, our worship as an offering to you this morning. Let it bring glory to your name. Father, we choose to reflect back to you everything you deserve. Father, we thank you for every blessing. We pour it back to you, Lord. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. God, we ask that you'd be with all those that are traveling for spring break, that you give them travel mercies, that they'd have fun and refreshing times. God, bring them back home safely. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Anyone with the word of knowledge, please come and share at this time. I'm looking. All right. Looks like none this morning, which is just fine. Just fine. Thank you. You guys may be seated. And those of you that are taking children to children's church, now's a great time for that. Well, pastors are traveling, but they'll be back here soon. They sent a greeting this morning, just wanting to say hello and love you to the church. We also have about 50 college students who are out and about. They're at spring breakaway, and they are having a blast. The whole theme of their retreat is seek. So they're going to talk about seeking the Lord in all kinds of different ways, seeking him in worship, seeking him in prayer, seeking him in devotion. They even have a girl session where they wrote all their own little booklets and songs on seeking him. And it's just really, it's really going to be a beautiful time for them. So if you think about it, they'll be concluding today. Just pray for them that the Spirit falls, that lives are touched and transformed. We want to make sure that they have a great time. Welcome to the house of the Lord today. It's going to be a great service. Pastor Tom is going to take us into the word of the Lord this morning. But first, we're going to go back to Aaron and Andrea.
All right. Well, welcome, everybody. And we're just glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. And if you're newer with us, we'd love to be able to connect with you. So there's a, if you're in the building in person with us, there's a connect card there in the pew rack in front of you. You can pull that out and you can scan that and fill that out. Also, if you're watching online and attending with us that way, you can do that via our church app. And so we'd love to be able to connect with you through that.
Amen. We have a ton of people that are watching online. We mentioned how people are traveling right now, and so we do pray over your travels, and we're thankful that you are watching online. We have people that have joined us from Moscow, Pullman, Gig Harbor, Deer Park, and Whitefish, and so all over the place, and it just shows how our little C church here is so much bigger because God can connect us with communities anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, as Pastor Dan mentioned, Pastor Tom will be bringing the word to us this morning. So would you welcome him? He's a great man of God, and I always appreciate how he is all in his faith, and he is all in his response to the word of God and how Jesus moves in his life and is able to communicate that to us in an inspiring way. So will you please welcome him with me, Pastor Tom Weaver.
Amen. All in with Jesus. No reason to get out. Yeah, that would be the wrong decision. And that's almost what we're preaching on today. So, you know, we're in the middle of a season that's called Lent. Lent comes from a Latin word like lengthen, you know, which just means to lengthen. And so we get longer days. Today, daylight savings time. It's a longer day. So right in the heart of Lent here. And Lent is a season that leads up to Easter, the greatest day of all time. Easter, resurrection, Easter. Thank you, Lord. Everything we preach and do in this church, from this platform, in our lives as followers of Jesus, flows out of what happened when Jesus rose from the dead and conquered death and conquered the enemy. The enemy thought he had his greatest victory, only to find out he had his greatest defeat. And that's where he belongs, is beneath defeat. So Lent, it's a season of repentance and of humility where we reflect and we evaluate our lives compared to the splendor and the perfection of God. So how are we doing? There's nothing like a good test or a good trial to help us see how we're really doing. It has its way of sorting things out and helping us to face the reality of where we're at. Our main scripture today is from tomorrow's Bible reading, and it is in James. For those of you that are following along in our church Bible reading, which I encourage you to do, you can find it on the app or get a hard copy tracking checkoff list in the back. But our main scripture today is from James. Let's honor the Word of God by standing to read today's scripture. James 1, 2 through 4. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles, trials come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Well, you may be seated. Doesn't that sound great? Perfect, complete, needing nothing. You know, we always seek that state of circumstances where we need nothing. And God defines this in a whole different way, where we need nothing because we have Him, not because we have perfect circumstances. Okay, so here we go. We're going to go on a journey today, breaking this down. The title of our message is Tests and Trials Build Our Trust Muscle. Tests and trials build our trust muscle. So 2 points today. Tests and trials help us build trust, and tests and trials help us be transformed. And so we're going to start with the first one here in a little bit, but tests, trials, and other words for those are troubles and tribulations. Tests, trials, troubles, tribulations, not necessarily our favorite things. All these troublesome T's. Oh, wait, my name's Tom. Right. Yeah. Yeah, those things don't feel good, do they? Looking at our scripture today, when it says, dear brothers, when troubles, another word for troubles is trials of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance, the word endurance can be perseverance, steadfastness, patience. It has a chance to grow. So James tells us, so let it grow. And the other word I wanted to highlight is the word perfect. It also means mature and complete, needing nothing. So let's go to our first point. Tests and trials help us build trust. Just like when we go to the gym to build our physical muscles and get stronger. How many of you here have ever been to a gym? A couple of you. The tests and trials of life will build our muscles. Resistance exercise. There is a purpose in the tests and the trials. Ultimately, they're used, and get this, ultimately they're used to connect us further to God as we learn to trust Him through everything that comes our way. God uses those tests and those trials to sanctify us. They help separate out that which is good and righteous in us and that which is sinful. They help us face our sinful attitudes and our motives, our sinful motives. At least that's what I'm finding. God uses them to sanctify us, to purify us, to build our endurance, though, and our loyalty to Him, to understand that as we go through these things and He's faithful, we learn that our response then is further faithfulness and loyalty to Him. You know, God is preparing a people. He is. You know, the revivals are happening. Our culture isn't well. Our culture is kind of sick. There's a lot of difficulty and a lot of tension, a lot of darkness. But that's not our destiny. Right. The culture needs a people that are being changed and transformed by God. Amen. Who know how to trust Him. Because that will shine light. That process of going through trials and tests and difficulty and yet shining the light that comes from trust and dependence and clinging to Jesus will change and influence culture. God's preparing a people that know how to trust him in the tough times. That will sing. That'll be a song that's sung through our lives that people will hear. And God will be glorified. James tells us to consider our troubles and our trials as an opportunity for great joy. You know, I have to admit, I've read that scripture for many decades. And often I'll look at that and go, oh, that's interesting. You know, that's novel. I wonder how that's done, you know. And the more you read it and then the more you see it confirmed in Scripture, you go, I think he means that. I think he means that. So if he means that, I better learn how to do that. I better learn what that means. Better learn the provision for that that was prophesied this morning. His provision is there every moment. You know, count it all joy when these trials and tribulations come. How is that even possible, we ask? I mean, it's like trust on steroids, right? I mean, this is jacked up trust. Yeah, or I'll call it graduate level trust, you know. I'm barely graduating from kindergarten trust, and here we have grad school trust. You know, recently my granddaughter Phoebe, though, your kids are amazing. I love children. I love my grandchildren. Oh my gosh, they're so refreshing. But, you know, here's a little, she loves to sing. Okay, I'll tie it in here in a minute. Here's a little video of her singing recently.
We worship you.
We worship you. Oh, I love that. Oh my gosh. But, you know, she was singing the other day. Jake and Val were telling me that their toilet was broken. So Phoebe makes it into a song. Our toilet is broken. Our toilet needs fixed. You know, and she's just like making this into a musical. And you know, she's very, very happy, unaffected by this, even though she has to use another toilet, right? But she's singing because ultimately, this isn't her problem. This is Dad's problem. And I think there's something there for us to learn. That ultimately, our lack of experience at facing whatever it is, our lack of answers, our feelings of desperation, ultimately, it's not up to me to figure it all out. It's really Dad's problem. So, Dad, what are we going to do? James here is commanding the Jewish Christians to consider their trials as an occasion for joy. New Living says, an opportunity for joy. To do that is going to require incredible faith. It's an act of faith. For instead of looking at the trial, the followers of Jesus are instead encouraged by James to look through the trial to the potential outcome. And that's a real key statement there. Look through the trial to the potential outcome. God's doing something. He's always doing something. He's always up to something. In our culture today, it's dark. That's not what we're to focus on. That might be a trial. It might cause us a lot of tension inside sometimes. And we might just go, how can they even think that or say that when we hear certain things in the news cycle? And yet, God knows. God knows. We need to look through the trial to the potential outcome. So the outcome is as we go through trials and tribulations and difficulty, the outcome is a stronger trust muscle. That's one thing. We get stronger by going through this with Jesus. And it's also greater endurance. The tests, the trials, and the troubles as we go through them. And all these things are things Jesus promised, right? He says in John 16:33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. That's awesome if it just ended there. But that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. He says, he promises it. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. So we can remain in peace as we go through the difficulties that we face. But the ultimate outcome, as we look through the trial to the potential outcome, the ultimate outcome is what we call stage four living, right? It's living in dependent dignity, right? Not just reacting to the circumstance or being a victim of it or just doing all the right things as an agent focusing on our responsibilities, but dependent dignity, clinging to Jesus. Rely on him for the ability to get through whatever it is that we're facing. And in the book of James, the context is significant. Because it's written by James, who is, we believe, Jesus' brother. And he was the head of the church at Jerusalem. And the Jewish Christians now were spread, Jews were spread throughout the Roman Empire. He was writing to the 12 tribes of Israel. And so they're scattered in many different places, cities, different cultures even. And life was not easy for them. They were always the minority, and they were persecuted. And they were often poor because they didn't have the connections to get the good jobs. So they were poor, they were oppressed by the Romans, they were persecuted, and they were going through all of these various trials and testings. And these Jewish Christians were tempted to give up. And they were questioning God. And they were allowing their testing to turn into doubt, into temptation, and into sin. And so James is saying, hey guys, there's another way. Don't give up. Listen to this. Consider your trials as an opportunity for great joy. For you know, when your faith's tested, your endurance grows. It has a chance to grow, so let it grow. Don't give up. So the joy that James tells them is possible is not a mere optimism. It's not just positive thinking. It's not just a mind game as they experience their poverty and their oppression. What James has in mind is an utter trust, an utter dependent dignity. That leads to a steadfastness, you know, which is a fidelity or a loyalty. It leads to steadfastness and loyally following Jesus, not compromising. The trust that's being built is a trust in God's goodness, that he's good. Circumstances, not so good. God, really good. And a trust in God's sovereign control of history and eternity, which we know it's true. And trust that God will work his will into their hearts. Like a potter that's molding clay. That's what he does with tests and trials. I sometimes almost physically feel my insides being molded and shaped as I take the pain and the difficulty and go to God and say, I need help. I'm being tested. And I need help. And I need an adjustment, like going to the chiropractor, getting adjusted. I need an internal adjustment. I need you to come and mold and shape my inside and conform me to your will. Trusting that those things are in play in the midst of our trial can lead to a sense of joyfulness. Because our connection to God is strengthened through the need to utterly trust him. When we're put in the position to utterly trust him, our connection to him strengthens, right? It gets stronger. Have you ever been slipping or falling and you grab onto something? All of a sudden, you have a really strong grip because your life depends on it. You know, so when tests and trials come, we find ourselves slipping, we grab onto Jesus. Guess what? That's where he wants us. So we curse the trial and the test that put us in connection to him, and yet that trial and the test was a gift because it caused us to go to him. Maybe when we were just being independent and just doing things our way. So they are a gift. their gift. And they are an opportunity for joy when we see through the trial to the outcome. And if the outcome is greater intimacy with Him, what more could we want? If you ask us at a neutral time, we'll all say that's what we want. It's just the journey to get there sometimes doesn't feel so good or may not be on our agenda. So the logic is anything that strengthens our connection to God is an opportunity for joy, because there's nothing more valuable in life than that. Because our connection with God lasts forever. It's the only thing we're going to take with us. The older I get, the more I think about the things I'm going to take with me. That's the only thing I'm going to take with me. And the influence, the eternal influence maybe my life has the privilege of having. So, and as I talk about this, I realize I don't know what you've been through, what your trials and tests, the tribulations, maybe even the evils that you've experienced. I'm not trying to trivialize those. I'm not trying in any way to be insensitive to what you've gone through. But I must be true to God's word. And if His word says this, and we'll find later, it says it in more than one place, by more than one author, that He must mean it. There must be a path forward for all of us, regardless of what we've experienced, to be able to make this real. It was prophesied today. There's the reality of our circumstances, but there's a higher reality. And that reality is what God's doing. And so that's where we want to be. That's where we want to dwell. So the Greek word for joy here, it's the Greek word chara, means cheerfulness. We've heard it preached before, cheerfulness. And I always say all the introverts like the idea of calm delight. So it's not just this exuberant, like, you know, overpowering, kind of joy. It's cheerfulness, calm delight. Calm delight. Comes from the root word kairo. That means rejoice, be full of cheer. But it also, I love this word because it includes the idea of being well and thriving. Being well and thriving. Pastor Phil talked about shalom. It's my favorite word, shalom is. Jesus came to give it, not as the world gives it, but as He gives it. And shalom means broken pieces made whole. Guess what? That's what our lives are. Broken pieces that are made whole. It actually means well-being. So this word is a cousin to that. It means to be well and to thrive. Even in the midst of really hard things, we can be well. And we can thrive even. Guess what? That would be a testimony, wouldn't it? That would be a testimony to the world, wouldn't it? So, I love this idea. We tend in our lives, we seek external peace. We want circumstances to be good. God seeks our internal wellness. We seek external peace. God seeks our internal wellness. And He provides for it. The tests become an opportunity to experience God in a whole new way as we trust Him in the midst of the trouble. This is where we get a test imoni. Sometimes I just have a moni. But He wants us to have a, involve God, we get a test imoni of what God can do. This has actually been a tough stretch. It's been a tough time. Gone through some things, you know, that you always hope you never go through, actually. You know, and when you start, I think I said that a couple years ago. Well, I've gone through more things since. But God is so good. He's so good, and He's so true, and He's so faithful. You know, I'm saved, right? To live is Christ, to die is gain. You know, we know where we're going. So that makes us dangerous, right? Because nothing can really ultimately oppress us. Because if we're not fearing death itself, we're good. We're good. But it has been tough. You know, 9 years ago, and this is like a praise report, you know, Tracy had 3 different brain biopsies, has a rare brain disease, but God has answered prayer, and this is 9 years later, and we didn't know we'd have 9 years. Yeah. So we're so grateful for that. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. She deals with a variety of symptoms, which is a test and a trial, and creates some difficulties, but God is good and is sustaining her and I believe healing her in many ways. And then this last July, I have already mentioned this, but I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, you know, and that's never fun to hear that. At least it wasn't like it didn't feel fun, but you know, and thank God, and I mentioned before, it's a lower risk version. So, hey, you know, I'm believing God for many decades left, but still, you know, it's in the back of your mind. Oh, you know, I forget that I have it. And then somebody mentions, oh yeah, so-and-so died of prostate cancer. You go, oh, I got that. That's a bummer. But that's a test, right? And I've experienced different, you know, even financial tests, you know, and it's even including being a victim of fraud. And that's a really kind of very complicated thing to experience because you feel embarrassed. And it's very humbling. But experiencing that. And the latest thing, so, you know, health, finances, I mean, anybody relating yet? Anybody with any health things? Or I'm just trying to, we'll keep going. On Christmas Eve, I go outside. I think I was going to get some beverage or something for our Christmas Eve dinner and go out to the garage where we sometimes will keep it to chill things. And I heard this loud noise. It sounded like a waterfall, kind of. I go, well, I know it's warming up, but I don't think there's that much snow on the roof. So I go outside and I look, and there's this like waterfall coming out right by our garage door at our house. And there's Christmas Eve. And so there's a video of what I found inside. Not the full force of it.
Dripping right here. Dripping right here. Ooh, wow, our garage door opener. That's not good. Dripping in there. So we have a bit of a plumbing repair we'll have to do. That was a bummer.
That was a bummer. I went and sat down for dinner. I didn't even tell my family. I go, I don't want to ruin dinner, right? So we sat down and we enjoyed Christmas Eve dinner. So that was our Christmas Eve flood. And then we had Christmas Day service here at church. And you know, up to this time, I'm realizing it was really cold in town, and I own some properties, some rental properties, and I realized, you know, pipes can freeze. They do, in, you know, especially if you have record lows. So we had like minus 30 degree temperatures, wind, you know, and with wind chill, it's just blowing on these places. And so I thought, you know, I was warning people, you better check your pipes. And here, I forgot that I had a hose bib in a garage. And so the plumbing's coming up over the roof and the garage isn't heated. And so then it just freezes and bursts in this one spot. I go, oh, I know exactly what to do. I went and there's a shut off. So I shut it off and went and ate dinner, right? So it's all good. But then, except that, you know, then you have to deal with the aftermath. But I love sheetrock. I do. Anyway, no. Anyway, the Christmas Day, though, after church, I felt like, you know, I better go look at some of these other places, make sure they're good. And so my son Josh is with me. We go to, everything's looking pretty good. You know, there's no water flooding outdoors, you know, that's good. But I went into this one place because it didn't have a door. It's a kind of it's a basement that doesn't have an outlet, really. Went in, and as soon as I opened the door, I heard this roaring waterfall. Yeah. And so I went down, and there's like 8 inches of water on the floor, 6 to 8 inches, wall to wall in the whole downstairs. And I know exactly where it's coming, so I go in there in my church clothes, and I had my special German hat on that I got, if you know, had that on my clothes. I go in and I kneel down on this bed under this waterfall. I'm being hammered by this water, and I try to open the door to the water shut off, but it's swollen shut because of the water. And so I finally get open, turn it off, called Pastor Dan Christmas Day. This is Christmas Day. Called Pastor Dan, and he comes. He's there in like 35 minutes with an extractor van. I don't know how many times we filled that 200-gallon van, but we estimate we took about 3,000 gallons out. We were hand baling using the extractor. You know, my sons, Jesse and Josh are there, and, you know, this is rather traumatic. You were there for about over five hours on Christmas Day. And that was tough. And you realize that this is a bad circumstance. But it's not going to just go away. And so I'd better go to God. It's not going to go away. So I'd better go to God and let him help me through this. Never faced this kind of thing before. Never wanted to. Actually was telling everybody how to prevent it. That was the agent part. I was doing the responsible thing. Thought I had it. The heat was even on and all of that. It was just a vulnerable spot. And record temperature lows. So here's some pictures of the Christmas Day flood. So Christmas, we saw Christmas Eve video. Here's a Christmas Day flood. So that's after we extracted. That's underneath this wood floor that I discovered we had. Look at that. That's underneath. And here's some pictures of the, so it had many layers. That's the wood floor on top and a subfloor underneath. And underneath the subfloor was all that water. So that all has to come out then. So all of that was ripped out. All of that was ripped out. All of it. Next slide. And so there's the equipment from Palouse Carpet Cleaning, flood mitigation specialist. So it's getting dry. Yay. And then, so this is what it looks like now. But then tomorrow, actually, after this was Christmas Day. So, you know, we're a couple months later plus, we get concrete poured tomorrow. So that'll be, we're making progress. But, you know, but my life was already full. I wasn't looking for more projects or to do a remodel like this, but God's good. So last night I'm preparing this message, thinking about what I'm going to speak, and just because he likes things to be fresh and he likes us to speak sincerely and genuinely from the heart, I get this picture sent to me. And so it was just a washing machine that was flooded, so not as bad. And then as I went over there and was cleaning that up last night, then this is what happened. Then I hit a shelf and got a cut on my head. That was traumatic in a couple ways. I mean, the cut is one thing, but man, that sure is barren up there. But anyway, so I'm dealing with all these trials and tribulations. I think my wife still thinks I'm handsome, but I, you know, early on in our marriage, we'd identify balding older men that have these little strings of hair coming across, right? I just don't want to, anyway, it's really close to that, so I'm working on it. Hey, I'll do something, I don't know. Okay. Yeah, tough things, right? We all go through tough things. Those are some of mine. But a strong trust muscle, in the midst of all this, a strong trust muscle allows our soul to rest in God when circumstances say we should stress out, be anxious, and be fearful. So building our trust muscle is important because Jesus promises we're going to have tribulation. But then he follows it up and says, but be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. We're going to see that theme this morning. We're seeing it. Be of good cheer. Count it all joy. Consider it an opportunity for joy. Okay, next point. Tests and trials help us be transformed. James 1:3 says, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance or perseverance, steadfastness, patience has a chance to grow. So let it grow. I love that line. My son Jake, he's going to come. He's going to help me with this point and give us some examples of how his faith has been tested. So
thanks, Dad.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Thanks for letting me.
It's great to have you here, Jake.
Yeah, be a part of your message.
We'll team it up. We'll team
been
it up
a while.
Here. Yeah. Well, yeah. So, you know, we got some new vans at church here.
Yeah.
And yeah, we got some new vans and at church and school. And Jake has become concerned.
Yeah. Very.
He's become concerned for the younger generation.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because their faith won't be tested.
No.
No.
In the same life-changing ways.
Yeah. Yeah.
With these new vans.
Yeah.
That theirs was with the old. So, Jake, tell us your concerns.
Yeah, have you seen these vans, first of all?
Yeah.
Leather seats.
Yeah, right.
They recline.
Oh.
Shocks that work.
Oh.
AC that works. Sorry. It took me a while to, like...
Yeah.
Process this, because, I mean, I'm looking at that going, what?
Yeah, seriously.
What?
Seriously.
I mean, when we get in the old vans, right, we sit down, and it's like... The history that has gone behind us, the weight of all of the people that have sat in those chairs.
Like all the springs are.
Yeah, are compressed.
Gone.
Yeah, there's no cushion at all.
Right.
And so you're just like lower back problems all the time.
Right.
And you're trying to sleep in these vans without getting head trauma or neck trauma.
Right, right.
Very difficult.
Tough, right.
What are they going to do with a leather seat that reclines?
Right,
They're going to get sleep.
Right.
How are they going to get tested?
Seriously?
I don't know. Right. I don't know. Right. I'm concerned.
Right.
I'm concerned.
Yeah, you guys had to trust God.
Right. Yeah. I mean, every time we get in a van, it's like, boy, I hope we're going to make it.
Yeah.
You know? This retreat could be a couple of different retreats. You know? Could be like a shop class, a MacGyver episode, and a retreat, you know? There's a lot. You never know. You know, learning
seriously.
How are these kids going to learn how to direct traffic in a snowstorm on an icy road outside of Kennewick?
Right.
You know,
right.
In the middle of a snowstorm?
Right.
Right.
Seriously. Seriously.
You got a semi coming. You got to get him out of the way. You're parked on the side of the road. You can't get hit.
Yeah.
You know?
Seriously.
It's dangerous.
Seriously.
So,
yeah.
You know? Testing,
yep.
Transformed.
Yep, right.
I mean, every time you get in the vans, it's a prayer meeting.
Yeah.
You're like, Jesus.
Seriously, right.
Please.
Right.
And so the miracles. You see the miracles?
Yeah, you do.
You lay your hands on the van and it makes it?
Yeah.
How is that? Amazing.
And you all four of my sons are still alive. I'm just super grateful.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
So, well, Jake, we'll be praying then for these young ones.
Please,
that they're,
please do.
So,
please
but
do.
Thank you for coming in and sharing.
You're welcome.
He actually did this spontaneously when we were out looking at the new vans, and he just went off. And I'm... It released a lot of endorphins, made me healthy, and, you know, we got to laugh in the trials. Oh, boy. Thank you, Lord. Endurance, though. Endurance. You know, we're called to do it. It's a Greek word, hupomone. I think it's one of Pastor Phil's favorite words. And it means cheerful or hopeful endurance. Cheerful, again. We see the word cheerful, cheerful or hopeful endurance. What a great description of the Christian life. One of hopeful endurance. Cheerful, hopeful endurance. Our entire life, right? We're saved. We're going to heaven. Not just that. That eternal life starts right now. We get Jesus right now every step of the way.
Yes.
We get him. We get to walk through life with him. Endurance, steadfastness, perseverance, not giving up. These words usually mean that you're experiencing something that doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good, but you keep going anyway. You don't give up, you don't quit, because there's a reward ahead. It's kind of like, I was thinking of climbing a mountain. It's kind of like that. There's a reward ahead. There's a joy set before you, similar to what Jesus was saying, but climbing a mountain. So here's some pictures of one. This is like 2004, I think, climbing Mount Rainier. You get up at midnight, and so we're almost up there looking at the sun rise. That was the sunrise, and now we're roped up, coming up. Dwayne Pepple's in this group, right? Terry Carlson, Howard, Dave, Catherine's dad, Howard. So we're climbing up this thing, and you learn to endure some pain as step after step. Roped up, and eventually you get to the top, and so there's our reward. Dwayne looks like the Arabian Knight there, to the right over there, and my son Joe was there, and Jonathan Davis was there too. It was great experience. But you learn how to endure. My sons have climbed different mountains with me over the years, and one of the things you get a shorthand. And so whenever we're going through something difficult or they're going through something difficult, we'll say, well, you know how to get there, right? You know how to get through this. You just put one foot in front of the other. And if you keep doing that, eventually you'll get there, or eventually you'll get through. And that's so true, that we got to keep going. We got to keep putting one foot in front of the other. When I got to the bottom of these stairs and I saw that 8 inches of water sitting there, I didn't even think. I just stepped right in. I actually had these shoes on. I stepped right in, went over, did what had to happen, and then I'm continuing to walk through this process that's not pleasant circumstantially, but God is good. And I am connected to Him. There was one moment I was sitting back there, Pastor Dan was preaching, and I hadn't heard from the insurance adjuster yet, so I have all the uncertainty, anxiety of what's going to happen with all of this, and I had to release the tenants from their lease and all of that, which is the right thing to do. And so going through all this, and I'm sitting back there just kind of in turmoil inside, and I go, Jesus, I need your help. This is becoming up here. It's becoming oppressive. And I need it to be down here where you're ruling and reigning my heart, not it. And so as he was preaching, the Holy Spirit just did a work in my heart. And I felt like him molding and shaping me. It was real. It was tangible. And I came to a place of peace. After that church service, at church, right back there, I got a call from the insurance adjuster. So God knows. God knows. So our sign on Grand Avenue recently has been saying, trusting in God doesn't make the mountain smaller, but it does make the climbing easier. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus, that you're with us every step of the way. He takes our hand and he says, let's keep going, Tom. Let's keep going. We got this. And seriously, we got to view life that way. And that's also how our endurance grows. He's our trainer, right? He's our coach. You can do it. You can do it. You know, I go to exercise classes and the trainers are always exhorting you. You know, you got this. Keep going. Harder, right? And I'm going, yeah, I'm giving her all she got, Captain. Right? Can't do that nearly as well as Pastor Phil. But James 1:12 says, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. That's our ultimate reward, right? The crown of life, dwelling forever with him. But it's not just a future reward that James has in mind as he's exhorting them to count it all joy. It's a present reward of his presence and of his help as they're enduring this difficulty. See, without endurance, you're not going to become mature. Like, you know, for example, how many of you ever jogged for exercise? I remember when I, you know, okay, I start up jogging again, right? At some moments in my life, I would have started up jogging again. I go out for that first run, and my body is yelling at me. It's saying, what are you doing to me, right? And you're just sucking air, and it's really hard. But then you do it again. You go, okay, right. You do it again, and then you do it again, and then you do it again, and then you do it again. And like Pastor Dan and Cassie, you know, they'll run a half marathon or something, or the Dorgans did that. And you keep doing it. You build some endurance, and that's how endurance is built. Test after test and trial after trial and getting through them. Right now, I mean, I can provide a lot of empathy to a lot of people in many different categories of life because of what Jesus has allowed us to go through. You know what? It feels really good to empathize with others and to connect and to support. It does. It's a privilege to do that. So enduring tests and trials allow our life to be transformed as we are conformed into his image. And that's what they do. Endurance is not the goal. It's the means to the goal of maturity and completeness in this James scripture. So our goal is ultimately Christ-likeness. And suffering helps us get there because we get to be fellow sufferers with him. Endurance helps us to the finish line. It leads us to maturity and completeness in Christ. James 1:4 says, so let it grow. Let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect. You will be mature and complete, needing nothing. So tests and trials will help us sift out the chaff of life, you know, the temporal things, so that what is true and important and eternal remains. Peter and Paul say very similar things to James here about rejoicing in trials. And if James, Peter, and Paul repeat the exact same concept, it should get our attention. I'm just going to say it really quick. Peter says in 1 Peter 4, 12 through 13, says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you." Wow. "As though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice." There we got that again. "Insofar as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed." And there will be that day when his glory is revealed, and we will certainly be glad that we didn't give up. Paul also says in Romans 5, 2 through 5, "Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege." That's really true. We're in a place of undeserved privilege. By his grace, we're saved in right relationship with God, where we now stand, and we are confidently and joyfully looking forward to sharing God's glory, aren't we? We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. This isn't James not anymore. This is Paul saying this. The exact same thing. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment. I love that. He will never disappoint us. For we know how dearly God loves us because he's given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to close with a powerful, a true, inspiring story of a family that has lived these scriptures out, and they've lived them out beautifully. This is a story of Joel Oduro Afrie and his family. It's happened in 1990. I'm going to show you a picture of his family here. This is 1995. Joel's the one next to his mom in the top right. Good-looking young man, huh? 1995. Joel just had his birthday on, Thursday. So he shares the exact same birthday with his older sister, who's to the far left. So I won't tell you how old he is, because he doesn't look that old. Anyway. Amazing story here, though. I learned about it last Wednesday, and I was overwhelmed, really moved. So he grew up in Ghana, born in Ghana. They moved to Nigeria for a time, then moved to Liberia based on his father's job. His father was a physics professor, PhD in physics, teaching physics at the University of Liberia. Well, there's a problem in Liberia. In 1989 to 1997, there was a civil war. You know, and about 200,000 people were killed. And millions were displaced. We don't even really know much about it. But there was an entity called the National Patriotic Front of Liberia and the government forces, and then this other entity. So there was really a three-way conflict going on. So here's the story as Joel writes it. "My father was a physics professor at the University of Liberia, and we lived at Fendel, a town for the university staff. By June 1990, the NPFL had reached Fendel, and that was our first direct contact with the war. Fendel became an NPFL base, and life became precarious. It was dangerous to even walk upright in your house for fear of being shot through the window." That's our brother Joel's story. "Every day was a game of survival, and food and water became so scarce the people had to invent new kinds of recipes for food, eating leaves and roots that were not previously thought to be edible, and rationing whatever little there was. The days and nights were spent without electric power because the soldiers had cut off the supply. During the despair of those times, the words of Isaiah 43, 1 through 3, were an important pillar that kept us going. These words had been spoken over my father in 1976, when he gave his life to Jesus. These were spoken over him in 1976. So 14 years later, they're going through this. And you'll see how apropos that word was. Isaiah 43, 1 through 3 says, "But now, Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you. O Israel, the one who formed you says, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. They needed those words. You'll see how here as I continue. One evening in September of 1990, during a time of prayer, God spoke clearly to my father, telling him that God, was taking us out of that place at 4 a.m. the next morning. They were going to escape. We did not know how that was going to happen. All faith. But we got ourselves ready because God spoke and put together whatever little provision we had for our journey to the capital city. And that was where that they would have a chance to catch a ship back to Ghana. Two young men from the church who knew the route to Monrovia, which was the capital city of Liberia, stayed with us that night so that they would help lead us on the right track. Everyone went to bed fully dressed and ready to leave. It's kind of like Exodus, right? Dad woke everyone up very early, and we waited for 4 a.m. But for some reason, the soldiers decided to spend that night hanging out just outside our house, having fun, shooting into the air. By 3:55 a.m., they were still there, and any kind of escape seemed improbable. However, Dad put his arms around us all to pray. Before he could even begin, there came a sudden downpour of rain. And the soldiers scattered into their houses. Joel said the Liberian soldiers don't like rain. And so at exactly 4 a.m., we slipped out the back door, up the road, and into the forest by their house. Because of the rain, the checkpoints, or the barricades set up by the soldiers to intercept travelers along their entire route, were deserted. Also, the moon shone brightly to guide us through the night, and we made our way toward Monrovia. It would have been about 17 miles, but the route they had to take took them 37 miles on foot. The trip involved crossing a couple of rivers on foot. Remember the Psalm or Isaiah? I'll take you through the rivers. You'll not be harmed. You'll not drown. Joel said, for all of the kids, you see how different, you can see all the kids, they're different heights. He said, it's like the water was at everybody's chest level, regardless of how tall they were. And they were all walking on the bottom of the river. Just miraculous. So they had to walk in the river, calling on Jesus with every step because it was a swift river. And somehow everyone got across safely every time that they had to cross a river. We did not take the standard route because they had to avoid soldiers, so they went 37 miles. At the harbor in Monrovia, they made it there on the third day to central Monrovia and had to wait about 3 weeks for a ship to take them out of Liberia. Finally, a ship came one day, and a crowd of desperate people who had been waiting for the ship thronged to the port. And we joined them in a hurry, he said. And by the time we got to the ship, it was almost full. And unfortunately, just before it was our turn to get on, their stairway was raised and the ship departed. You can imagine the disappointment. By the time the next ship arrived 2 days later, the desperation was greater. Boarding started at about 4:30 p.m. and the crowds pressed and surged all evening and into the night. It was now about 3 a.m., and the crowd was so desperate that people were being crushed to death. At the mouth of the stairs, where the pressure was very intense, my father and three of my siblings got separated from the rest of us. They managed to get on board, and Dad tried to turn back to help the rest of us, but the soldiers would have none of it because of the intense pressure. Joel was with his mother and other siblings, and the last born, who was just about 1 year old, who was screaming because he was being crushed. Mom finally gave up, and we left the crowd and found somewhere to sit. You can just imagine the desperate feeling that would be, being separated and then just going, we give up. While they sat there, a man came up and asked my mother if we were not planning to get on the ship. Mom replied that she had tried, but it was impossible. He asked us to follow him, and I'm still not sure how he led us through, but somehow we got onto the ship without much of a struggle. This man was not a soldier, but the ship allowed us to get on. And thereafter, the stairway was raised and the ship departed on October 1st, 1990. I'm convinced to this day that that man was an angel. So home at last, on October 3rd, 1990, we arrived in Ghana. We stepped onto the shores of Ghana with practically nothing but the clothes on our back. Dad and Mom started life all over from scratch. Joel said his dad had no shoes. He got on the shores of Ghana barefoot. He had no credentials. There's nothing showing he was a college professor. He had no credentials. He had to start completely over. No money. Seven kids. They lived with his dad's brother in a two-room place. There are nine of them. And in the brother's family, there's four or five. So that's 13 or 14 people in a two-room place. Starting over. Joel said it's been a challenging road, but God has been very faithful. This experience shaped our lives growing up. It cemented Dad's faith and confidence in God. He is a man of raw, uncomplicated faith. If God says something is yellow, then it's yellow. Case closed. No amount of reasoning, logic, or contrary evidence can change that. All of us kids grew up with this kind of training. We have learned to believe and trust God above anyone or anything else. All of the kids, all seven kids, love Jesus. They all follow Jesus. You know, Joel's getting a PhD in artificial intelligence. I mean, the guy's brilliant and talented and amazing and humble. And I love him. Our lives are so enriched by our international community. So grateful and blessed for the just... by all those relationships. And, you know, I shared some of the things I'm going through. Nothing compared to that. You know, there's always somebody going through something worse. We just need perspective. But most of all, we need Jesus. We need Jesus. And I'm so grateful that God sustained Joel's father and mother and was with them all and miraculously delivered them. He's so good. He's so trustworthy. Our God is trustworthy. Let's trust him with everything we have. Let's let him let the circumstances of our life, the difficulties, the trials, the troubles, build our trust muscle. And also let's let those tests and those trials transform us into his image. He's so good. If you want prayer for difficult things, you might just go see Joel, you know. He can believe for God's goodness in the midst of difficulty. God bless you all. Pastor's returned today, so that's great. Thank you, Jesus.
That was a fantastic perspective. I think that's the type of message that we should listen to every Monday morning in preparation for the week ahead. Because the truth and the wisdom that Pastor Tom was just sharing with us in humility is applicable all week long. You know, may we all be able to see through the trial to the other side and let that pull us through so that our testimony can be like that of Joel's, where he said, well, the road has been challenging, yet God has been faithful. So that's your challenge here this morning, is to keep that at the front of your mind going, well, maybe this road is challenging, but I know God is going to be faithful, and let that pull me through. If you would like prayer for anything that you're going through, we're going to have folks down here after the service that would love to pray with you and help seal in and walk with you through that journey that you may be going through now.
And if you're new with us this morning, gosh, we would love to connect with you. Don't head out the doors before stopping by the guest services desk. We got some people who would love to meet you and let you know about small groups and other ways that you can connect with this church. We'd love to meet you and not just let you walk out of here without meeting somebody and having a smile. We've got a gift for you back there. And then as we go, be blessed. Enjoy the week. We'll see you on Wednesday maybe for our midweek service, or next Sunday, and it'll be a great time. So be dismissed.
Well, that was an amazing message by Pastor Tom. I know that last story was just incredibly touching and really is a powerful story of putting trust in God and seeing how He truly is the sovereign Lord. He has a plan and purpose for us, and He sees us all individually. And so I pray that this message also touched you in a personal way, that you're able to see what God is saying for you. I know for me during this, there are trials that I'm going through, and it really just allowed me to refocus where my trust is and how much control am I still trying to hold on to versus like the word, the encouragement from the Lord today where they said to just empty yourself completely and allow God to come in and just give all your trust to Him. And so we are so thankful many of you joined online. I know Lana and Loetta were online and Pastor Darren Merrill was online. We had the Owens family that joined us and the Combs family as well. So many of you, we are so thankful you are part of our family. If there's anything you need, please send us an email or get connected through our app, however you need to get a hold of us. I have a Facebook Messenger. You can reach out to me personally as well. We'd love to connect with you. And so on behalf of Pastors Phil and Carrie Vance, have a wonderful Sunday and we'll see you next week.
You have been watching the weekend services of Living Faith Fellowship, a Spirit-filled local church serving the communities of Pullman, Moscow, and the surrounding region. We are a group of people who love God and believe in His power to change lives. If you responded to the teaching today or have any questions about Jesus, the Bible, or how to grow in your walk with God, we would love to get in touch. If there is anything we can do to serve you, please let us know. You can connect via social media, our website, or by calling the church at 509-334-1035. God bless you and have a wonderful week.